I hope you can see the text. If not, just let me know. So the Bhagavad Gita is one of the most popular spiritual texts from India. It's one of the most popular and important texts of yoga. For those people who think that yoga is a physical practice or a physical exercise, of course, that may come as a shock. But for those of you who know that yoga is the teachings that Krishna imparts to Arjuna, you understand that this is the yoga which we are referring to, is about the union of the individual self with the universal self. So first of all, I wanted to give you a little background about the Bhagavad Gita before we start with the actual commentary. The Bhagavad Gita comes from a larger text, a much larger epic, in fact. It is one of the two great epics which come from India. It is the longest or largest epic in the world. It's larger than the Iliad or any of these other great epics that have been written here in the West. It is made up of 100,000 verses, and it is known as the Mahabharat. Maha means great, Bharat means India or knowledge. So this great epic, as it is also known as, is actually the source from which the Bhagavad Gita comes. The Bhagavad Gita comprises of 18 chapters taken out of this great epic. So I wanted to give you a general, quick summary of what this epic is about. The epic Mahabharat is the story of cousins, warring cousins. They are five brothers called the Pandavas on one side, and their cousins, the Kauravas, 100 of them, they are 100 brothers on the other side. So the kingdom is what they are fighting over. They are princes, and the kingdom is what they are fighting over. One, the Pandavas, the five brothers, claiming right over the kingdom. And on the other side, the 100 Kauravas claiming their right over the kingdom. So this is what the basic story is about. And as you can well imagine, that the story is a symbol of the mind, and the war which takes place, the great epic, the great Mahabharat, is basically all about a war that takes place between the cousins. Is actually a symbol of the battle in the mind. There are very different commentaries that have been written on the Bhagavad Gita. I just wanted to briefly tell you about them because it shows us how different people, different traditions interpret these commentaries, or rather this text, in different ways. So we have some very famous commentaries on the Bhagavad Gita written by Mahatma Gandhi, written by Lokmanya Tilak, written by Vinoba Bhave. These were well-known karma yogis. They have interpreted this text, the Bhagavad Gita, from a point of karma yoga. On the other hand, there have been commentaries written by the very great scholar Dr. Radhakrishnan, another great scholar called Satvalekar, and these are more academic or scholarly works. Then, of course, is this commentary that we know, the one that I am reading the actual verses from, and that is known as the perennial psychology of the Bhagavad Gita. That's how it looks, the cover here, the perennial psychology of the Bhagavad Gita. And it's a commentary by Swami Rama. This commentary is a very modern commentary because it sees yoga as a form of psychology. And we talk about yoga psychology. There are two texts, actually, which really explain this yoga psychology. One is, of course, the Bhagavad Gita, which is a more general text for seekers, for sadhaks. And the other text is the Mandukya Upanishad, which is really the core of yoga psychology. So the commentary by Swami Rama sees it from this perspective. It's a very modern commentary. It even refers to therapy and counseling and sees this from a very modern perspective and therefore very, very useful for the modern person. What we will be discussing every Friday, and I presume that this might take at least a year for us to go through this commentary, is that I'm going to discuss the Bhagavad Gita with all of you from the perspective of a meditative tradition. So this, what we will discuss, takes on the approach of the Samaya tradition, sees this from a meditative approach, and we understand the symbolism behind this. We understand what it is to be a yogi and to understand the deeper meanings of some of the verses in the context of meditation. So that's how we shall be going through the Bhagavad Gita every Friday for perhaps, I don't know how long it'll take, perhaps a year or so. The basic idea about the Bhagavad Gita is this beautiful text is taking place, is located on the battlefield. It's quite amazing that the ancient yogis wrote not only great spiritual texts, but also amazing from the point of view of literature. The setting is two armies. On one side, the armies of the Kauravas, and the other side, the army of the Pandavas. One of the great heroes from the side of the Pandavas, we can call them the good guys. The Pandavas hero is Arjun. And Arjun says to Krishna, oh, should I be fighting with my relatives, with my cousins? Doesn't seem right. And so the dialogue takes place between Arjun and Krishna. And this is the amazing setting of the two, of the amazing setting between the Krishna and Arjun, the dialogue, which then are the amazing teachings that come out of it, known as the Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita means, Bhagavad means celestial, heavenly, celestial, and Gita is song, the celestial song, the heavenly song. And because it's written in verse, it's poetry, it is really exquisite poetry, all of it. In fact, the entire Mahabharata is exquisite poetry, 100,000 verses, the largest epic in the world, and the Bhagavad Gita itself, this amazing setting has some of the finest eternal teachings. Yet, the Bhagavad Gita is not an original teaching. There is nothing original about it. That may come as a surprise to some of you, because maybe you do not know that the Bhagavad Gita is itself a kind of a summary, or you can say it's the juice of all the ancient teachings of the sages. The ancient teachings of the sages were taught in the Upanishads. These come from the Vedas. These are very ancient. They are up to 5,000 or 6,000 years old. And these teachings are quite esoteric. very difficult to understand for most people. So the author or authors of the Mahabharata, when they wrote the Bhagavad Gita or put down all these teachings in the mouth of Krishna, they basically summarized all the eternal teachings of the Upanishads, all concentrated in 18 chapters of the Bhagavad Gita. So there is a saying, Sarvo Upanishado Gavo Dodha Gopala Nandana. That means of the milk was taken out of all the Upanishads. One imagines the Upanishads as a cow, and the milk has been taken out by Krishna and is given to Arjun in the form of these teachings. So it visualizes the Upanishads as a big cow with a lot of teachings, but Krishna milks this cow and gives this milk to Arjun. And so we see that this is in fact a concentrated juice of all the teachings, which is what makes it incredibly beautiful and amazing text. It has also been put in a form which makes it extremely interesting to read, especially in the setting of a battlefield, especially in the context of the story between the warring cousins. And then these teachings have been taught for centuries, for millennia, in every village in India, during the monsoons. There's a special time, and these stories were narrated in different forms, and so the teachings were conveyed in a beautiful story form. You know, very easy. Even the little children would be able to take in and drink that milk. So, really a wonderful way of conveying very, very high and esoteric teachings in a very, very simple, practical manner. So one says, there's a saying in India that as long as the Mahabharata and the Ramayana, the other great epic, is being taught or is being heard, as long as that happens, the tradition will remain alive. Okay, did somebody want to ask something? Because there are some people who have not been muted, who are not muted. I would suggest you please mute yourself. It causes a disturbance otherwise. If you don't have any questions. Matthias, did you want to ask something? Or you have unmuted yourself? Yes, thank you. Also, Swarnalatha, since you're new here, I will mute you. Sure you can figure out how to mute yourself if you need to. Or you can use the chat to ask questions whenever you want. So coming now slowly down to the main protagonist, the heroes of this great text. One is Arjun and the other is Krishna. Krishna and Arjun are friends. But they're not just buddies, you know, like we think of as friends. But Krishna is the revered friend. He's not just a friend, but he's a friend that Arjun respects. He has a great deal of respect for Krishna, and he's a revered friend. Krishna actually means the dark one. And you'd wonder why the dark one. Well, the dark one also means center of consciousness. That is Atman. It's another word for that. And Arjun, the word Arjun means one who makes sincere efforts. So a great deal of symbolism always in this text. You have two who are equal, yet one is a revered friend. The other accepts him as his guide, as his counselor. And our Arjun means the one who makes effort. It's basically nothing other than a good sadhaka, a good sincere seeker. So I come to the very first chapter, chapter 1.
Hi Radhika, I have a question.
Yes, please go ahead.
So when you said dark one, before yeah. you gave your explanation, the thought that came to my head was immediately, you had mentioned before that the word teacher means also like gravity.
Mm-hmm.
Guru means gravity.
Yes.
The symbol of gravity is a dark black hole. So
yes.
Is that also, does it also have something to do with this, the dark one? For Krishna, or is it just...
Well, that would be stretching it, I think. But yes, as I said, the dark one, Krishna is consciousness. You know, Krishna consciousness, there is a kind of a group that spreads the teachings of the Bhagavad Gita, and they're known as Krishna consciousness, because Krishna actually means consciousness. Chaitanya means consciousness. Yeah? So Krishna means, Chaitanya means consciousness. And of course, we can stretch it to say, yes, guru, black holes, gravity. That's very possible, Krishna. When one studies Sanskrit and one goes deep into it, they had a great deal of knowledge that is very clear. Whether there was really this connection implied or not, I cannot say. Okay, Vishal has a question. As we, as jivas, meant to put ourselves into the shoes of Arjun, and why were not other Pandavas not narrated by Krishna? Why Arjun? Okay. Well, there are five Pandavas I mentioned. So the first one, the eldest brother who claims the throne, and which is why the battle starts, the first one is Dharmaputra. Yudhishthira. Dharmaputra means, dharma means, well, righteousness. The second brother is Bhishma. He is said to be the son of Pavan, the king or the god of the winds, the wind god. He has power over the element air and wind. So, is considered to be very, very strong. He's the strongest of all the brothers. He has the power of the wind behind him. The third one is Arjun. He is the son of Indra, who is the king of the gods. And the symbol of Indra, he is the king of, or the god of rain and thunder. He is actually very much like the Scandinavian god Thor, whose symbol is also a thunderbolt. So, Indra, Arjun's father, has a symbol thunderbolt. If you know what a thunderbolt is, it's lightning. It is basically lightning, and lightning is nothing other than highly concentrated energy. That is focused, like a laser beam, one-pointed mind. That's what it is. Then we have the twins, Nakul and Sahadev. And these are the sons of the Ashwini twins, and they represent dawn and dusk, sunset and sunrise and sunset. That's what they represent. So, these are the four brothers. So why is Arjun selected? Well, he's the one who is one-pointed. He has the backing of all the others. The Ashwini twins are the physicians of the gods. So the twins, Nakul and Sahadev, also represent physical and mental health. So that is what any good sadhaka needs. He needs to be upright, have righteousness on his side, to be very correct, have integrity, to have strength. Strength here means sankalp shakti, to have determination, to have physical, mental health, and then to be one-pointed. So these are the qualities required of any good sadhaka. So they choose Arjun because he's one-pointed. That's the symbol of the mind, a one-pointed mind with the backing of all the other brothers. That's why we have chosen that. So this is the symbolism behind it. So the verse itself, verse number 1 from chapter 1, Dhritarashtra asked, "What did my sons and the sons of Pandu do, O Sanjaya, gathered together on the battlefield of righteousness, Kurukshetra, with the intent to fight?" So I need to explain to you a little bit more about these characters. The Kauravas are the evil cousins and the Pandavas are the good guys. The father of the Kauravas is Dhritarashtra. And Dhritarashtra has a very interesting character because he is blind. Now you ask yourself, why is this man blind? What is the meaning behind this? To be blind to things is poor cognition. That means you don't want to see things as they are. Ignorance, avidya. Out of avidya spring the 100 sons, which symbolize evil, or all things which come out of avidya and ignorance. So that is the deep symbolism behind the story where Dhritarashtra is blind. And his sons and the sons of Pandu. Pandu is Dhritarashtra's brother, and therefore these cousins, his sons, the Kauravas, and the sons of Pandu called Pandavas, are at the battlefield. So he says they're gathered on the battlefield of righteousness. That's what the original Sanskrit says. Dharma Kshetra Kurukshetra. The battlefield is called Kurukshetra, but he also calls it in Sanskrit Dharma Kshetra, the battlefield of Dharma. Now, if you understand that, what you're basically saying, that this is the battlefield of the mind. This is the battlefield of righteousness, Dharma. You're fighting for Dharma. And who's fighting for Dharma? Every seeker, every sadhaka who's on the path is fighting this battle all the time within himself. We all have parts of us which basically are ignorant. We have ignorance in us. We have negative qualities in us. We have evil qualities in us. We may not want to call them evil. We may not think of it as evil. When we think of evil, we think of terrible things like dictators, people who torture others, people who murder others. We think of these as evil. I'm sure that none of us would describe ourselves as evil. But we have these tendencies. We do sometimes manipulate others. Sometimes we want to flatter others because we want something from them. All these qualities are basically coming out of ignorance. So we have these qualities in us. But we also have positive qualities in us. We all do want to develop. We do want to evolve. So we have qualities of Dharma. We do try, since we are on the path, to stay on the path, which requires strength, which requires determination. So we have qualities of determination that are symbolized by Bhima. We try when we meditate to be one-pointed like Arjuna. We are all aspiring to have good mental and physical health. And as we develop and we grow, that's what's happening. We are strengthening the good side. And that's what the battlefield is about. This is the battlefield of righteousness. It is Dharma Kshetra. So in this setting, Dhritarashtra, the blind king, is speaking to Sanjaya. Sanjaya is his assistant. And Sanjaya is narrating to the blind Dhritarashtra what is happening. Because Dhritarashtra cannot see. He cannot see what's happening on the battlefield, so he's narrating to him. And that's how the Bhagavad Gita begins. So we go to verse 2 of the first chapter. So in the first verse King Dhritarashtra asked, and now Sanjay replies. Duryodhan, seeing the force of the Pandavas deployed in the battle formation, approached his preceptor Drona and addressed him in these words. O preceptor, see this great army of the sons of Pandu deployed in battle formation by your intelligent disciple, the son of Drupada. Here are brave men like Bhima and Arjuna, with their great bows intent upon war. Yuyudhana, Virata, and Drupada, each commanding 11,000 chariots. Drishtaketu, Chekitana, the virile king of Kashi, Puruchit, Kunti Bhoja, and Shaibhya, the bull among men. Here are the strident Yudhamanyu, the virile Uttaman Maujas, Abhimanyu, the son of Subhadra, and the five sons of Draupadi, all of them great commanders. So the next few verses from 2 to 6, they are explaining the setting of the battlefield. Duryodhan is the eldest son of Dhritarashtra, that is the eldest among the Kaurava cousins. So I would say he's the really bad guy. He's the one who's taking a claim to the throne. And he sees the Pandavas, his cousins, and they have a very big army. And he approaches his teacher. His teacher, Drona, is the teacher also of the Pandavas. They had one teacher. Both of them, the Pandavas as well as the Kauravas, had only one teacher, the same teacher, Drona. Now that is of interest. If you think about it, if the Kauravas and the Pandavas are a symbol of the mind, there's only one teacher. It makes perfect sense that they both have one teacher. But if there's a part of the mind which the teacher can train and help and grows, but there's the other part of the mind which is ignorant, what happens to that part of the mind when we develop? Well, ignorance or evil tendencies, negative tendencies, we need to let go of them. That means they need to die. So these evil tendencies represented by the Kauravas must be killed. And therefore, in the battlefield, Drona, he is both the teacher of both of them. He doesn't take sides. He's actually both the teacher of both. But for various reasons, he is on the side of the Kaurava army. And Duryodhan, the eldest of the Kauravas, approaches him and says, see what a fantastic army the Pandavas have. There are so many great warriors there. So they're studying the battlefield. Now we need to know what we are facing when we go into the mind, when we meditate. This is what this verse is about. We need to understand the battlefield. It's foolish to go into a battlefield without knowing what's happening. If you are a general, you need to have an overview of the battlefield. You need to understand who is where and how to fight the war. So that's what Duryodhan is doing. He is trying to understand this battlefield. What happens eventually is that Arjun also goes out in the center of the battlefield and looks at both the armies. He's trying to get the overview. He's trying to understand the field. And that is what a meditator needs to do, to understand the mind field. We need to understand how it works. That is why we need to have a basic understanding of yoga theory, how the mind works. And that's what is very useful. When we understand the symbolism here in the Bhagavad Gita, what these evil tendencies represented by the Kauravas mean and what the positive tendencies represented by the Pandavas, what these mean, we begin to understand the symbolism. It helps us understand the teachings and how we can lead our life, how we can ourselves develop and grow. So I will not go much into detail with the names here of these warriors. They are not relevant, not directly relevant to the teachings itself. Suffice to know that Duryodhan is the leader of the Kauravas. He is the greatest enemy of Arjun and his brothers. So we go to the next verses, 7 to 9. Now, O Drona, the best of the twice born, learn of those who are distinguished among us, the leaders of my army. I tell you of them so that you may recognize them. Yourself, Bhishma, Karna, and Kripa, conquerors and victorious ones, Ashwatthama, Vikarna, the son of Somadatta and Jayadratha, and many other brave men, ready to sacrifice their lives for my sake, they who attack with many weapons and all of them experts at the art and science of command. So Duryodhan now speaks to Drona and he addresses him as the best of twice born. I want to explain to you what that means, twice born. Twice born are, in India, the Brahmins. The Brahmins, if you're born in a Brahmin family, when you're about 9 or 10 years old, you get a thread ceremony. There's a thread ceremony, and with this thread, it is conferred upon the young one the teachings and of the Vedas and the Upanishads. So the child at the age of 9 or so, so to say, is reborn. And on receiving these teachings, gets a new life. And that is why the Brahmins, who at one time were the custodians of the teachings of the Upanishads, the Vedas, were known as twice born. Fortunately, this is not the case anymore. It is not the privilege of only a few. The teachings are given to all those who are qualified. And it is not something that comes merely from birth. It's not a birthright conferred only on Brahmins, but it is now given to those who are qualified. So the Brahmins to this day may be custodians of texts. They hand down these texts orally from father to son. But in the yogic tradition, which is based on merit, only qualification is important. So the teachings and the practices are handed down in a parampara, in a tradition, in a lineage, from teacher to student. And it doesn't matter if one is a Brahmin or coming from any other community, any race, any gender, whether you're man or woman, irrespective of your education, if you are qualified, you can have the teachings. What does it mean to be qualified? Qualified doesn't mean that you have to produce a degree from somewhere or you have to have done something or the other. Qualified means that you have a deep driving desire in you to develop, to grow, to transform, for which you are willing to practice, for which you are willing to have a certain level of integrity, have the values, and that you are willing or have a sharp buddhi. You know, you're able to see things as they are. You're not blind. So these are the qualifications that one needs. So Duryodhan has now addressed his teacher Dronacharya as twice born, and he is now showing him the leaders, not in the Pandavas army, but he's now showing him the leaders in his own army. These people are his leaders in his own army. Bhishma, Karna, Kripa, Ashwatthama, all these are in his own army. So why is he now explaining to him about the leaders in his own army? Because one needs to study oneself. You need to know the battlefield. You need to know your own strength. You need to know your enemy as well as yourself. And they have some very, very brave commanders, very brave warriors on their side. But so do the Pandavas. So the two armies are well matched. This is the setting of the battlefield. And that is how all of us, when we sit down to meditate as meditators, those of us who are on this path of fire and light, who are training, transforming, learn to become aware of one's own positive as well as negative qualities. It is much easier for us, for the mind, to look at one's own positive qualities. But it is very difficult for us to look at our negative qualities. But this is very important for us if we want to win this battle, the battle of the mind field, Dharma Kshetra. Yes.
So the question is that these Kauravas, you mentioned at the start that they were the evil and that and they represent the negative qualities in us.
Mm-hmm.
And Pandavas, they represent the qualities which listen to the Buddhi and or to listen to the teacher in us and
yes.
function positively.
Yes.
Now, is there some more symbolism to the Kauravas and Pandavas, and what makes them positive and what makes the other, other set negative, so that, we can look at ourselves and say that these are the Kaurava kind of qualities in us and these are the Pandava kind of qualities in us. Is there a way to... Because negative and positive are a little bit general words.
Yes, yes. Well, ignorance, anything which leads us further into the bondage of karma and action, anything which makes our life more complicated is ignorance. Anything which frees us, gives us greater freedom, leads you to greater joy, greater health, greater well-being, feeling of love and selflessness, these are positive qualities.
Okay.
Yeah?
Yeah, thanks.
Yes, Balaji?
I want to make you.
Yeah.
The battalion in the Kurukshetra, the battalions of Kauravas are much higher than that of Pandavas.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, in number.
The numbers, that's right.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's the important part. That for all of us, our negative qualities are outweighing the positive qualities. And so you see the Pandavas, they have the qualities of Yudhishthira, who is... upright, has righteousness. The second one has Sankalp Shakti, strength, that is Bhima. The third one is one-pointed, that's Arjun. And the other two have physical, mental health, that is the twins, the Ashwini, the sons of the Ashwini twins, the sons of the physicians, of the gods. But you see, I said they're well matched, the armies, because these five are enough for the 100 Kauravas. though there are only five, they can fight against the 100. And so the qualities which come out of our mind, the negative qualities in us, jealousy, anger, hatred, greed, selfishness, there are innumerable qualities which are negative. They keep coming endlessly. But we only need five positive qualities. If we strengthen these five qualities, if we remain upright, we maintain our integrity, we remain authentic, we remain true to ourselves, if we maintain our determination, we are able to stay on the path, if we can remain focused and one-pointed, if we can take care of our health, organize our lives so that we have good health, then we have everything we need to fight this battle against the Kauravas. And even though those negative qualities outnumber the positive qualities, still, in spite of that, we can win this battle. All the great spiritual stories of the world, whether they are things like Lord of the Rings, or any great stories like this, again, good versus evil, you will always see that the good are outnumbered by the evil. The forces of the evil are always greater, but good always is victorious. And the reason is that we don't need that many good qualities. We just need a few good qualities and we need to strengthen them. And that's why...
On that note...
Sorry, you wanted to say something, Krishna?
I think I was interrupting, you were trying to finish something, so...
Yeah. No, all I wanted to complete was that with these few qualities, we can win. And that's what the message always comes from all these spiritual stories, all these good versus evil stories, which inspire us. Yeah, and you wanted to ask.
Yeah, so it's just something, an image that came to my mind that I wanted to add. Actually, there is, you know, if you look at our solar system, there's just one Jupiter. And studies have shown that the presence of Jupiter is what is keeping out some trillions of comets and asteroids away from Earth and kind of protecting it. So even if the one good force is... strong enough, it can keep out many of, destructive forces, which could have destroyed, life on Earth, so.
Okay, yeah, interesting, insightful little example. And just for others who may not know, the planet Jupiter is in Sanskrit known as Guru. Guru, Thursday, the planet Jupiter is Thursday, and in Indian language is known as Guruvar. Planet Jupiter is Guru, and so it's interesting that you said that it is this planet which is in a way protected Earth from a lot of asteroids and etc. that might have destroyed life on Earth. So that's a nice little twist to that. So once again, in these verses 7 to 9, Duryodhan is looking at his own warriors, studying what is happening over there, and that's something we need to do. Also look at our negative qualities and understand what these mean, how we can work with these, and these are very subtle. These are very, very subtle in us, and nobody likes to think of themselves as evil, and I think none of us are really evil in that sense. But we have negative qualities and we can work on these.
Can I say something?
Yes, of course, Scott. Go ahead.
Just going back to the thing about Jupiter.
Yeah.
What I find remarkable about that is that you said it means also Guru.
Yeah.
Which also means, has the connotation of heaviness.
Yes.
You know, the heavy one.
Yeah.
And so that leads me to think that in a way, that's kind of evidence that this scripture is inspired. Because how could they have known back then the mass of Jupiter, was so large?
Oh, yeah, Scott, you'll be surprised. They knew that. Jupiter, They knew that because recently, 2 years ago, I was in the western state of India called Gujarat, where I went and visited a solar temple. There are many solar temples in India. And what was interesting is that already 800 years ago, when this temple was built, it was built on the Tropic of Capricorn, I think it is. Exactly on the Tropic of Capricorn, or is it Cancer, whichever, one of the two, in the Northern Hemisphere. And it was built in such a way that at sunrise, exactly every morning at sunrise on a particular day, spring equinox, the sun would, the first rays of the rising sun would hit a diamond which was on the idol at the third eye. A diamond placed on the third eye of the idol. And the idol was, of course, Surya, the sun god. And the entire temple was built out of interlocking stone, like Lego building blocks. It was not made with any other cement or anything. Huge temple made of pure stone and surrounded on all sides by the different planets, etc., showing that they knew already the entire solar system, they knew the zodiac signs, they knew about the Tropic of Capricorn, they knew the equator, they had detailed knowledge of all this. They were able to predict solar eclipses, everything. If they were able to do that, why should they not be able to know the mass of Jupiter? And why would they call Jupiter Guru just as a coincidence, which means heavy? And Guru also means gravity. So it was clear that they had this knowledge, that the knowledge was lost in between and has now been resurfacing in the last 7-8 decades after the colonial rule has come to an end and the Indian traditions of Ayurveda, yoga, other Indian sciences which went underground, which were not encouraged by the British, which were in fact totally suppressed in order to enslave the people, are surfacing, resurfacing, and have surfaced in the last 7-8 decades. And hopefully that process will continue. Things like Vedic mathematics, for example, shows a very, very superior form of mathematics from where the numeral, the Hindu numerals came from. The numerals that we use today, the zero and all, came from the Hindu numerals, which are called by everybody Arabic numerals, but they came through Arab to Europe. Therefore, they are called Arabic numerals, but the Arabs got them from the Hindus. So all this knowledge was already there. What I find fascinating is how the planet Guru, gravity, the meaning of heaviness, teaching, all this is interconnected. And that is a fascinating discussion that we will continue in the next discussions as well. As we go through the Bhagavad Gita, we will see much more of the symbolism and go deeper into understanding the meaning behind it.
I just wanted to add that I just realized that all this is a universal truth here. Because, when I heard first of the Bhagavad Gita many years ago, I thought, oh, it's some Indian stuff, and this is really not for the Western mind.
Yeah.
But actually, this is a very universal approach here, including all the knowledge about the stars and all. This is just one thing which is encapsulated here. The universal mind is described.
Yeah.
So I find that quite fascinating. It is not an Indian mind here. It's,
no.
It's a universal mind.
Yeah, Joachim. Absolutely, very well put. This is not just something for Indians. The beauty of this translation by Pandit Arya is that it's really in very simple English. It's very easy to understand. Of course, sometimes I have seen many translations, and some of them are so off from my perspective, or from the meditative perspective, that if you would read them, they create all kind of superstitions. They're absolutely, in my opinion, not only bad, they are even misleading, some translations. So the beauty of this is that it is explained in such a nice way that one sees that this is the study, a universal study. It's about universal truth, and it is for a universal mind. It is not meant for academic study by some Indians sitting and crunching Sanskrit, you know. So, very well put. These teachings are a treasure for all of humanity. It is not something claimed only by one race or one people, but it is for all humankind.
We just have to work on the Indian names. Maybe we can represent them. Which was German, which was Western name.
Shall we call Bhishma? Okay, this force of ours, supervised by Bob, is large but enhanced. It's easier to read, maybe we call Bhishma Bob. But.
And Krishna would be Carl.
Chris. Arjun is gonna be. Has anybody said.
Archie.
So now you can rewrite your own commentary and translation of the Bhagavad Gita. Okay, so verse 10. Sorry, Scott, continue.
I was just going to say, I just thought it was so important to bring that back up because, I mean, it should just inspire us with such confidence that we're on the right path. Mm-hmm. You know, when these congruences come together, you know, mm-hmm. to inform us, mm-hmm. and just to increase that, you know, sankalpa.
Yeah.
It's just very inspiring. Just like a sense of wonder and awe, really.
Wonderful. Yeah. That's so beautiful to hear. Yes, indeed. I have often experienced that sense of wonder and awe, and when sometimes when I just think about this and I say, what a gift, what a beautiful gift some of these scriptures and texts are, and where would we be without them today? This is a treasure of humanity. There's a beautiful saying said by Mahatma Gandhi, and he said, if all the literature and all the knowledge of the world were lost, but only the Vedas would remain, it would be okay. If all the Vedas were lost, but only the Upanishads would remain, that's all right. If all the Upanishads would be lost, but only one would remain, and that is the Isha Upanishad, then it would still be okay. So for him, all the teachings and all this wonder, you know, was encapsulated in the Isha Upanishad. But I think the Bhagavad Gita also quite captures all that beautiful knowledge. And that's all humankind needs. I mean, everything else is nice, all the other treasures, but this is what inspires awe and wonder. It's beautifully put, Scott. Thank you. So, we could stop, but the verse 10 is very nice here. So, it actually is merely focusing or repeating what I mentioned when Balaji contributed, that the Kauravas army or force is much larger. And so this verse actually sort of repeats that. So verse 10 says, this force of ours, supervised by Bhishma, is large but inadequate. It's large but inadequate. However, the force of these Pandavas, supervised by Bhima, is small but adequate. So what does it mean? The bad guys, the Kauravas, springing out of ignorance, very large force, but all the same inadequate. While the Pandavas, a very small force, but still adequate. Yeah, they are still well matched, you know. This brings me to a wonderful story from the Mahabharata, which will illustrate, for me, a very, very beautiful story. Krishna was friends with Arjun as well as with Duryodhan. Duryodhan, as you remember, he's the eldest of the Kauravas, the super bad guy, you know. He's the one who's talking here, and he's the one who says, you know, our force is not adequate. And both of them, Krishna as well as Duryodhan, go to Krishna. Arjun as well as Duryodhan go to Krishna, asking for his help in the battle. Duryodhan is first, and it happens that Krishna is resting. He's taking a little afternoon nap. He's resting. And so Duryodhan sort of barges in and seats himself close to Krishna's head. You know, he seats himself near his head. Arjun comes later and he gets a seat and seats himself close to Krishna's feet. When Krishna is done with his rest, he opens his eyes and his eyes immediately fall on Arjun, who is at his feet. And so he greets them both and he asks Arjun first, what can I do for you? Kauravas, that is Duryodhan, gets very upset and said, but I was here first. You should ask me first. So Krishna says, well, I'm sorry, but I saw Arjun first, so I'm asking him, what do you want, Arjun? What can I do for you? Arjun says, I want your help in this war. So Duryodhan says, I also want your help in this war. So Krishna says, I will be on one side alone and unarmed, and on the other side my army. So Arjun, because you were here first, or rather I saw you first, you get the first choice. What do you want? Do you want me alone and unarmed? Or do you want my entire army? And guess what Arjun chose? Arjun chose Krishna, alone and unarmed. He agreed to drive his chariot. And of course, Duryodhan was extremely thrilled about that. He said, oh, wow, that was a silly choice. I would have taken the army. But that's good, because now I get Krishna's whole army. What use is Krishna alone and unarmed? But what he did not realize was that Krishna is the center of consciousness. And Krishna is, in this case, the symbol of Buddhi. He represents Buddhi. And without Buddhi, we cannot succeed in any battlefield, in anything in life. And so, he had a very large force, Duryodhan, the Kauravas, but it was still inadequate. And the Pandavas had a very small force, and Krishna on their side, alone and unarmed, but still it was an adequate army, enough to fight the Kauravas. Okay, thank you everybody for being here, and we will continue our discussion next Friday at the same time. I hope you enjoyed it, and have a nice weekend, everyone.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Radhika. Welcome, everyone.
Such a joy. Thank you so much.
Thanks for being there, Scott. Nice to have you.